OK, so this is going to be, I think, a three-part presentation. So I'll start by recording how we can use the boundary event method in frequent. So this is basically a quicker rehash of the talk of last year. And then we'll have Xavier Kless will have a, let's say a more research-oriented presentation. We'll talk about how we can use multi-phase formalism to design efficient domain decompression methods for optimized Schwarz methods. And then I will finish by showing the code that actually implements the method that Xavier introduced. And I will make a quick live demo. Okay. So first, a quick recap on what is the boundary element method. So let's say I want to solve a scattering problem in the infinite domain. So I have an obstacle on the appear, boundary gamma. I have an incoming wave of dg.
C'est la caméra surtout.
Technical arrangement. And so let's say so I want to solve the Evans equation in the scatter FT solution of the equation. So you have the directed boundary condition U equals minus the impending wave on the boundary gamma plus radiation, Sommerfeld radiation conditions at infinity. And now if I can use basically this representation formula here to compute u at any space, any point in space x by making use of the green kernel here, which has this expression in 3D for the Helmholtz equation. And basically, I know that there is a unique solution p here living on gamma, for which this representation formula is true. And so now, instead of searching for u in an infinite domain, which is a little bit technical, I only need to find p, which now lives in the boundary of the obstacles, which is on gamma. And how do we do that? So basically, we will be able to write the variational formulation for the boundary integral equation by imposing the Dirichlet boundary condition in a weak manner. So just like in FEM, you can have a test function multiplied by a test function q here and integrate on gamma. And if I do that and I replace u with the representation formula here, I will end up with the equation at the bottom of the slide. And so now I have a double. The left hand side, I have a double integral of gamma with the green kernel here. You have unknown p on the test function q. And I have my standard right hand side at the right side with a simple integral on gamma of my impending wave. Okay, and so now we kind of run one dimension, right? Because now the problem is only posed on the skeleton. So after discretization, so I need a surface mesh discretization of my boundary gamma. And then I would like to discretize these equations. But the price to pay is there is a double integral and the green kernel actually does not vanish anywhere. And so we end up with a full matrix. The coefficients are actually quite expensive to compute because you need to have quadrature rules for double integrals, and also you have the green kernel that is not so easy to compute with complex exponentials and so on. Okay, so this is the simplest problem, but for every problem you can actually have different formulations that are all their merits and drawbacks, and that but all the methods make use of one or a combination of these four building blocks. So the single layer operator here, which we actually just used in the previous slide. And then we have also the double layer operator, where you have a normal derivative here. It's transpose, where the normal derivative is other variable. And then the hypersingular operator, which contains two normal derivatives. And basically, every boundary integral formulation is made of these building blocks. And so, as I said, the boundary, the matrix coming from the discretization of such of the boundary element method are quite expensive to compute. And so, we need efficient libraries to do that. And so, in Python, Python is interfaced with the BMTool library. BMTool is written in C++ by Xavier Kless. And it can handle Laplace, Yukawa, Helmholtz, Maxwell equations for now, in 2D and 3D, and can do P0, P1, P2, Lagrange, and other elements, and also surface Fourier Thomas elements. And it is available on GitHub. Okay, and as I said, we have a dense matrix B, and you see it's a quadratic cost in storage and complexity, so both for assembly, storing, and using it. And so we try to make use of compression techniques to reduce these costs. And so let's just assume that B can be written as such a sum with R terms, with vectors J and VJ. And if R is small enough, and basically the complexity of using this B now is linear in N and also proportional to the number of terms in the set. And so if R is small enough, we'll say that B is lower. But the problem is we don't have equality usually because B will not be lower. But we can always write the singular value decomposition or SVD of B with here the sum with singular values sigma j and singular vectors j j. And the first idea is to truncate this sum and take the first few terms, and we will obtain a Lorentz approximation of B. And obviously, it's only a good approximation if the singular values sigma j quickly decrease. And also, drawback is that it's pretty costly to compute the SVD. And it also requires all coefficients of the matrix, which, as we saw, are expensive to compute. And so there are some, so without going into too much detail, there are some approximations of the SVD that are much less computationally expensive. For example, the partially pivoted elliptic cross approximation or partial ACL computes an approximation of the singular of the first terms of the singular value decomposition and only need two times n coefficients proportional to the number of terms in the sum. And so we try to make use of that when we want to compute long approximations of some blocks. And I'm talking about blocks because now there's a problem is that now Venn matrices in general don't have fast decreasing eigenvalues. For example, on the right, you can see for a single layer operator, the singular values, so they decrease, obviously, but they decrease pretty slowly. So any truncated SVD will not be an amazing approximation of the matrix. But what you can observe is that on the left, you can see a representation of the absolute value of the coefficients of the matrix. And you can see that near the diagonal, we have a large value. Near the diagonal, we have what we call near-field interactions, which are interactions between two basis functions that are close to each other in space. Usually these interactions have more information and are not really low-rank in essence. But you can see that away from the diagram, we have far-field interactions, so interactions between degrees of freedom that are far away from each other in space. And for this interaction, usually the green kernel is very regularized. And that means that, in a sense, the far-field interactions are low rank. And so the idea is to view the matrix as a hierarchical representation of a block matrix. And basically, we will identify which blocks in the matrix can are part of the near field interactions. And we just need to assemble the full blocks. And then which blocks can be compressed with, for example, partial ratio. And so that leads us to how we define and represent a hierarchical matrix. So we first start by doing a partitioning of the degree of freedom of our problem. And so basically, we have a recursive clustering of our degrees of freedom, a geometric clustering, so like this, for example, for a cavity. And from this cluster tree, we'll be able to have a block tree representation of our matrix. So basically, we have two cluster trees here, the target cluster tree and the source cluster tree. And usually, they are the same, since the matrix is symmetric. And then we will be able to traverse this block tree recursively and look for admissible blocks. And work verifies a so-called admissibility condition. That is to say, are the two cluster and target, the two target and source clusters sufficiently far away from each other so that we can try to compress the blocks. And so the first iteration is the whole block, right? So this is at the top of the tree. Is the block compressible? Of course not, because it's a full interaction. And so we then go down levels in the block tree to try to look for smaller admissible blocks. And if the block is admissible, we try to compress it using partial ACA. And if not, we go down levels. And so you can finally, we end up with a so-called H matrix here, which can be represented like this, which is basically just a list of blocks. And you have in red the non-compressible blocks, which are built in full, but that represent the near field interactions. And then the green blocks are low rank blocks, which were compressed using partial ACA, for example, with the number representing the rank of the low rank matrix. Okay, and so all of this is implemented in the H2 library, which we developed with Pierre Marchand is here. And it's a C++ library which is available on GitHub. And it interfaces with Ubuntu and Trifel in order to for the user to use all of these methods. And it's also a parallel library with two levels of parallelism. So the process level of parallelism is a bound decomposition of the matrix, where each MK process will hold the bound. In the bound decomposition. And then inside the bound, we can use OpenMP for the parallel assembly within a node memory, and also for the parallelization of H matrix vector or H matrix matrix products. Okay. So this was the software stuff. And so now, how can you use all of this in free time? And so the first thing you need is a geometry, right? So now, thanks to Axel Fourmont, we have access to a lot of methods to build or extract surface meshes or line meshes from, to represent your geometry. So for example, Here, you can use a square tree function, which will construct a surface mesh in 3D. So the new type is meshes or surface mesh. And basically, it will use a coordinate transformation, transform a square or rectangle into whatever surface you want. So for example, here, this transformation to get a torus. You can also use the move mesh to free function in order to transform any mesh in 3D to a surface mesh using, once again, user defined coordinate transformation. And then you can also extract a boundary mesh from any volume mesh. So in 3D, if you have a mesh free in 3D, you can use dot gamma to extract the whole boundary surface of GS3. Or if you just want to extract a subset of lavets, of boundary lavets, you can use the extract function. For example, here specifying that I want to extract triangles with only one and lavets one and two. And you can do the same for 1D meshes.
So, for example, we can use the border keyboard, which you probably already know, in order to build a 2D mesh with bin mesh. And so it is the same syntax, but you can also use the self coordinates in order to actually build the 1D line mesh in the 3D space. And then you can use your border in the bin mesh L function, which works just like bin mesh. And then you can use, you can construct it like this, or you can also once again extract any
one boundary of a 3D mesh from the bulk here with the extract function, or also a gamma.
And you can also extract in 3D a boundary mesh of a surface mesh meshes. Once again, using gamma or extract function. And there are much more operations that you can already find in the FreeFM documentation. Okay, so now that we know how to handle the geometry part, let's see how we define the element operator or the equation we want to solve. So for now, we can only solve scalar equations. And so basically, this equation is going to be Laplace equation for k equals 0, Helmholtz equation for k. Real positive and Yukawa for full imaginary k. So basically, you can solve these three questions just by finding your k. And you can use the Bell kernel keyboard in order to define your Bell kernel that you want to solve. As I said previously, there are four main building blocks for any BEM method, so single layer, double layer, hypercellular, or control double layer. And so in the constructor, you can specify the string here, which tells frequency which operator you want to solve. And then you can specify your code, or specify which equation you want to solve. And we'll see that you can do the same for potential with BEM potential, and potentials are used to reconstruct the solution everywhere in the domain, output domain of your trucks. Once you have your BEM solution on the border boundary, and so now we can use these BEM kernels to define a BEM varational form, which with the same keyword as in finite elements, so VARF. And so now what changes is that instead of simple integral, which is a double integral, right? So you have a new keyword in 2D, X2D. And that's how people know that you're doing BEM formulations. And then you have the keyword BEM here, which takes as argument your kernel of choice and unknowns and test functions of your version of today. And you can obviously do that in 2D, X2D for surface meshes, or for a 1D line meshes in 1D X and D, as you can imagine. And you can also, instead of defining the kernel in the script and using it in the Varchar form, you can directly use it in the BEM constructor. So one line to define your Warshawer product. And so just like in FEM, now you can discretize, you can assemble the matrix corresponding to this linear system like this, H equals your Warshawer problem. But you need to load the BEM plugin to do that, to have access to the interface of H tool and the BEM tool in order to build the matrix. And so now the type, the new type is H matrix instead of matrix, which will be sparse in the case of finite elements. Okay, and so as I said, for now I just showed the example with the first 10 formulation, but you can solve the same problem actually with other formulations. So for example, second kind formulations and combined formulations, which can have their merits. So for example, the combined formulation is more expensive to compute, but better conditioned. So it's easier to solve the linear system with an iterative method. And so basically a combined formulation, as you can guess, we combine with is a linear combination of two different kernels. So for example, you can do a linear combination like this with the hypersingular operator, the double layer operator, and you can use that in your Warshawer formulation. And also usually for second kind and combined formulations, you also have a mass term with a sparse matrix in the formulation. And you can simply add it in the Warshawer form. Using int 2D, since it is a simple integral for the mass term. And so all we have two simple scripts, let's say, in the distribution already in order to solve a GLT or a Neyman problem with the three kinds of formulations. So the code solves the same problem three times with three different formulations. And so you can if you want to know more about BEM, how to use BEM, how to define the different formulations, you can look at this example. Okay, so now the last thing to do is to solve a linear system. For that, so the H matrix type constructor actually have some parameters that you can tweak. So you can, in particular, choose the compressor you want to do, so partial SA by default, SA or SVD. And we aim to add more in the near future. The target compression error, epsilon, the admissibility parameter eta. So the larger eta is, the more blocks we try to compress and build a long matrices and other parameters. And all of these parameters, you can also change their default values globally in the script by using global variable names. The another important thing is that the BEM library is a parallel, since H2 is actually a parallel library. And so whenever you want to solve a BEM problem using this plugin, you will need to use a parallel FreeFM. So even if you are using one core, you still need to use FreeFM++ MPI and not just FreeFM++. And if you actually want to use the parallel features, which are pretty transparent to the users, the FreeFM interface, you can use FF and TLRun with the number of processors, but Pierre will talk a little bit more about all of the parallel stuff this afternoon. Okay. And so now that we know how to assemble the matrix, we can also display the matrix to see the picture of the blocks. Print some infos on the assembly of the matrix, so it's like computing time, number of Laurent blocks, and so on. And then we, as in FEM, we just assemble our right hand side with the single here. And then we need to solve the linear system. And so we can use the H minus one very compact syntax to actually solve the linear system with H tool. And by default, GML with a simple Jacobi preconditioner. But since you have also access to the parallel matrix vector product, we can also do more clever preconditioning techniques. And there are already some examples in the documentation using, for example, PETSI. And so now I was able to solve to find my ansatz on the boundary. So I solved my problem on the boundary. And if I want to reconstruct my solution anywhere in space, I will need to use the potentials. So I need to define my potential with the Bell potential theorem. And then I can define my potential variational formulation, which this time is a simple integral here. And we put instead of them as keywords, and I will be able to use this variational formulation to be a rectangular H matrix, which basically goes from my them space, finite element space on gamma. So UH here is a source space, which is the space of my them solution. And the target space is any finite element space defined on my out mesh where I want to reconstruct the solution. So, for example, here I'm saying that I want to reconstruct a piecewise linear representation of my solution on this mesh S. And so I can define my rectangular H matrix corresponding to the potential formulation. This partial formation. So now I just need to do a matrix vector product using my BEM solution U, which lives on gamma, and then I can reconstruct the solution on the whole output mesh. And then I can, for example, plot my solution. Okay, so that's basically how you can use the boundary element method in free frame. So you, as I said, there are a few examples already that are fully functional and show you how to use all the different formulations available. And so I just finished by showing some
larger scale results. So for example, here we have an S-shaped cavity. So a cavity is a screen, which is a non-orientable boundary. And so the only formulation we can use is the first chain formulation. So the thing with the first chain formulation, we end up with a kind of an e-condition linear system, which is a little bit of a drawback of any first chain formulation. And we actually need to apply a clever domain decoration preconditioning to solve the linear system. So for example here, use a short domain decomposition preconditioner in the coarse level on the coarse mesh. So I will not go into detail because Pierre will talk a little bit more about all the preconditioning stuff and parallel domain decomposition methods this afternoon. But a few numbers with this preconditioner can solve the linear system with 7 general iterations and 0.5 seconds. On 200 cores, and then compute the solution on this square in 7 seconds with the potential. And this is so all of this is obviously the MLC equation. I forgot to say, but here we also have a plane wave scattering from the submarine. And so this is we have Neumann boundary conditions. And so this is now a closed surface. So we are able to use, for example, a combined field formulation, which is a little more expensive to compute, but has much better conditioning. And so, for example, here, with only a diagonal preconditioner, I can solve the problem in 38 generalized iterations in 1 second on 2000 cores. And I had 1600 degrees of freedom for the linear system. Okay, and so I just conclude by giving some pointers on what we want to work, what we started working on, and what we want to work on next. And so in free time, we want to we'd like to define in the kernel and in the language the possibility to have composite operators, which can be made of different blocks, sparse, dense, hierarchical blocks, or user-defined functions, and so on. And
These are direct applications on, for example, vectorial dam problems such as Maxwell equations. Because for now, we can only use, we can only do scalar problems for them. But this will help us make a very solving Maxwell equations with an element method pretty easy also for the user. And also, allow us to define same BEM coupled variational formulations directly and in a monolithic way instead of having to build the blocks separately. And so for H-tool, as I said, we try to add more compression techniques for long blocks because, so we try to add the block ACA, hybrid methods also. Using some interpolation techniques, randomized SVD, and so on. And we also try to work on the LU factorization for H matrices, which will help design more efficient solvers, direct and hybrid solvers. So this will conclude the BEM presentation. Now I will let the floor to Xavier Kless. We'll talk about more research oriented presentation for domain decomposition.